بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ربي ياسر ولا ياسر I usually don't like to speak sitting down, but I have no choice today, so I have to do it sitting down. Of course, you could also lecture lying down, that depends what you say, that's what's most important. My dear friend, Dr. Safavi, who's like my brother, asked me to come here to London on my way back from Rome in a very crucial and difficult meeting with the Pope and the Catholic authorities on the future of Islam and Christianity, which practically exhausted me because I was the head of the Islamic delegation. Most of the responsibility laid on my shoulders. Inshallah, Allah Ta'ala will accept what we try to do there. And so I came to London on the way. I've not been in the city for some years, and I'm glad to be with friends again. I've lectured at Imperial College before 90% of the people in this room were born. So I know this institution quite well. The subject of this talk was chosen actually by Dr. Safavi or his assistants, I don't know who they were, but called Islamic Spirituality and the Needs of Humanity Today. But before beginning my discourse, I want to mention once again, as was already mentioned, this is the 700th anniversary of Sheikh Safiuddin Ardabili. Not as well known in Western Orientalism as he should be, but he's one of the most important figures of Islamic history, not only in Tasawwuf, but also history itself, because it was he who founded the seminal and extremely important Silsila Tariqa of Tasawwuf 2 centuries before the rise of the Safavid period, and that in turn led to the transformation of Iran into a state for the first time after 900 years. And so all Persians and the Persia of that time included Afghanistan, much of Central Asia and Caucasia, and for a while of Iraq, owe a great deal to this remarkable man whose spiritual heritage is very much alive in Iran today and is being revived, fortunately, during the last few years, thanks to the efforts of Dr. Safavi and his colleagues and friends within the country. We are all grateful to him. I believe that the revival of the Safavid order will play a very important role in the future of Iran itself and the areas around it. I'm sure others will speak about him on other occasions, and so I must turn, because my time is limited, the time set for me, to speak to you about Islamic spirituality, and there will be a time for question and answers after my talk is over. Let me begin, because I'm always very picayunish about defining terms. What do we mean by spirituality? The term spirituality is a newcomer to Western languages. In the 16th, 17th century, you never saw this word. When there was so much spirituality in the West, no one in English spoke about spirituality. You will not find a single text of the Elizabethan period, for example, in which the word is used. The word began to be used actually in the late 18th, early 19th century in French, la spiritualité, and gradually came into the English language. And it's both a very important term and a very ambiguous term for many. In America, where I teach now, and much of Europe, many people are interested in spirituality, but not religion. It's like saying they all love walnuts, but they don't like the shell that contains the nuts. But unfortunately, this is one of the characteristics of our day, to which I stand extremely opposed. And there's also a great deal of pseudo-spirituality that is going around. Let's remember that spirituality comes from the Latin word spiritus, which means ruh, in Arabic, and in Arabic and Persian we have 2 words for it, ruhaniya, ma'naviya in Arabic, but we use ma'naviyat mostly in Persian. The Arabs don't use it in this sense always. But these 2 terms, the word ma'naviyat from the word ma'na in Arabic meaning, the meaning of things, the inner meaning of things, and of course ruhaniya coming from the ruh itself, which is a Quranic term used several times in the Quran, especially in the famous phrase ar-ruh min amr rabbi. So technically, anything spiritual should be min amr rabbi, should deal with the spirit. And it's in this light that I shall discuss Islamic spirituality. There's so much pseudo-spirituality going on in our world that one needs to emphasize this at the very beginning. There's no possibility of access to the spirit except through the forms that the spirit has revealed to us in the various religions of the world. And therefore, the sacredness of the shell, of the outward aspect, is very, very important to remember. Islamic spirituality can be defined as in the more general sense, has anything having to do with the spirit, the ruh. Of course, that makes it a very, very vast subject. And starts with the Quran itself. You just heard the tilawa, the recitation of some verses of Surah Al-Hadid, and you all, especially those who are Muslims, felt that it exudes with spirituality. The Quran is the source of all Islamic spirituality, complemented by the Sunnah and the Hadith of the Prophet, and also the being of the Prophet, the presence of the walaya in his being, which later on is transmitted over the generations in various ways and through various channels, and it creates Islamic spirituality in the technical sense. That channel is twofold, as far as religion is concerned, but also has ramification in the fields of poetry, of art, and other fields to which I shall get in a moment. The twofold is, first of all, the crystallization of Islamic spirituality in Sufism, which cuts across the Sunni-Shiite divide. There are Shiite orders, like the Safavi order itself, and there are Sunni orders, and there are those which have both Sunnis and Shias in them. It cuts across the whole spectrum. And secondly, it's crystallized in the spiritual, esoteric, inward dimension of Shiism itself. Shiism itself also has fiqh and law and so forth, of course. But I'm talking about the inner teachings of Shiism, which are very close, in fact, to tasawwuf and issue from the same source and have complemented each other in many ways, to the extent that, for example, Imam Raza, alayhi salam, the 8th Shiite Imam, is also one of the poles of the Sunni Sufi orders, as with Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, his Quranic commentary, which is the first esoteric commentary which has survived. We do not have the comment of Sayyidina Ali. They say he wrote the commentary, but nobody has seen it. But that of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, part of it survives, and was a great source of inspiration for both Sunnis and Shiites. So in a sense, Islamic spirituality cuts across the Sunni-Shiite divide. And in fact, it is the most profound bridge between the two. There is no way of really being able to create an accord between these two major branches of Islam, except through Islamic spirituality. Now, where does Islamic spirituality manifest itself? Let me say that it manifests itself in the Sharia itself. The daily prayers are both external forms of spiritual practice and inward forms of spiritual practice. The Prophet, who was al-Insan al-Kamil, the universal man, never stopped saying his daily prayers until he died. He died shortly after the last time that he made his ablutions and said his prayers. And so all the rites of the Sharia, not only the Salat, Namaz, but all the other rites, of course, possess a spirituality on their own level. But I'm not going to deal with those tonight because of the limitation of time. What I wish to deal with are the specific fields of Islam and its civilization, which are the bedrock for the flow of spirituality over the centuries throughout the Islamic world. And these include, first of all, as I said, Sufism and Shiite esotericism. What is the goal of Sufism? The goal of Sufism is to go from the outward to the inward. We just read that Allah, who are awwal wal akhir wa dhahir wal batin. Paradoxically, God is also the dhahir of things, the exterior of things. Otherwise, there would be no world. And that's the most difficult divine name to understand. How can God be dhahir when we cannot see him? The Sufis try to understand this by gaining access to the batin, and through the batin to be able to understand that even the dhahir is the dhahir of the batin. That is, every outwardness is really a manifestation of an inner reality, of an inwardness. And that is the goal of the Sufi life, to be able to, first of all, to realize this within oneself, to be able to live inwardly, to live from the center, from the heart, where the divine throne resides, according to the famous hadith, قَلْبُ الْمُؤْمِنِ عَرْشُ الرَّحْمَنِ. God resides at the heart of all of us, except many of us are ourselves alien to our own hearts. But that is the source, really, of all spirituality. And what tasawwuf tries to do is to open up the doors of the heart, to melt this crust, the melting of the heart to which the Prophet ﷺ referred so often, saying that the dhikr is the dawa, is the healing for the heart. to open up the heart to the reality that is within it. One doesn't have to go anywhere else. God is already right here within us. It was not only Christ who said that the kingdom of God is within you. We have its exact parallel in the Quran and in the Hadith, of course. Then there's, of course, the practices of the Prophet, which guide us how to reach this inner life. And all of the authentic Sufi orders go back to him. The word Sufi was not used until the second century. But neither was the word Hanafi or Shafi'i or Ja'fari or many other very, very important religious terms. But the reality was there. In a sense, if there are no Taliban around, I could say that the Prophet was the first Sufi in the deepest sense of the term. It is that Sufi that we try to emulate and to follow. To follow the Sunnah of the Prophet, the Uswa Hasana, to try to live like him as much as we can, emulate his virtues, and try to embellish the soul with the perfections which in their ultimate limit was given by God to the Prophet. In Shi'ism, this perfection is extended to the Imams, through Sayyidina Ali, who was the gate of this walaya, this inner power of the Prophet. Nubuwa, the prophecy ended with the Prophet, his Khatm al-Anbiya. But walaya continued after him, and shall always be until the end of the world. The world cannot exist without the presence of walaya. And this is the belief of Sunnis, Sufis in one way, and Shi'ism is concretely embedded in the 12 Imams, the 12th of whom, of course, is for us living. I'm a 12 Imam Shiite, and although I write about Sufism and Sunnism and so forth, but I was born in Iran, I'm a Seyyed, and so I, as a confessional aspect of what I present to you from myself, is of course our belief that there's a living presence of walaya through the 12th Imam who has never died. And so there's always a spiritual guidance available in this world. There's no man or woman who lives in any age who has the excuse that there was no spiritual guidance in my age, therefore I did not follow a path. There's always a path that is open for those who wish to follow it. God always opens a path to them. This is one of the conditions of accepting the power of walaya. The power of walaya is also its presence. Not only its guidance towards God, its presence. To be human, I once wrote, is to live under the sky. And the sky always represents transcendence. There's no place on earth in which there's not a transcendent dimension. Wherever you are on earth, from Borneo to even cloudy London, if you look up, you see the sky at least once in a while in London, in other places of the world more often. That you have to compensate for inwardly. I don't know how you do it, but more power to you. The transcendence is always there. And what Tasawwuf tries to do is to make us aware of this reality, to change our way of living. Our way of living is based on forgetfulness, ghafla, what the Sufis call ghafla, negligence, forgetfulness. We forget. If we could only remember, we'd all be saints. But the Quran itself is dhikrullah. The whole Quran is there in order to allow us to remember. And the greatest prayer that one can ask God is, God, help us to remember to remember. The first remembrance is our remembrance. The second remembrance is the remembrance of God. And that is the heart really of Tasawwuf. Everything else is secondary. All the various movements, the awrad, the sacred dances, the sacred music, the great poetry, the great art that has been produced, all has one goal, and the goal of remembrance of God, to remember God at all times. And so that is the heart of Islamic spirituality, which Sufism has tried to preserve, and despite all the ups and downs, especially in the last few centuries, the attacks made against it from two sides, from the modernists and from the so-called fundamentalists, whether it be Wahhabi or Salafi or whoever they are, who think that the walnut is only there to have a shell. They don't want to pay attention to the nut inside. Nevertheless, it survived and remains a living force within the Islamic world with all the opposition that comes against it. And this opposition has resulted in the catastrophes which we see in the Islamic world today. a pure outwardness, which in the name of Islam destroy all that is spiritual and beautiful in the tradition and in the civilization. But in addition to that, you have within Shiism, and I wish I had time to talk more about Shiite spirituality per se, but I have to cover the whole field. In Shiism, you, in addition to the Sufi orders, which are Shiite, which I just mentioned, like the Safavi order, the Nematullahi order, and so forth, Zahabi order in Shiraz, you also have a living esoteric presence in certain Shiite prayers, in recitations, in intercession of the Imams, in contact with the Imams, and of course the Prophet, who is the origin of the chain of the Imams, and many other practices, which are kind of exoterism. So even ordinary Shiites who are not aware of some of the deeper meaning of the prayers that they perform, the Jawshan Kabir, or the, which are the thousand divine names, or the Ayah Arafah, which said Hussein, alayhi salam, after whom I'm named because I was born on his birthday, performed, and Dr. Sabavi performed that for me when we went on to Mecca a few years ago in Arafah itself. That prayer is not just an ordinary religious prayer. It's a gnostic, mystical, esoteric prayer, which contains almost all the truth of Islamic spirituality within itself. I'm talking about many prayers of this kind. But human beings, being what they are, they need a whole civilization in which this spiritual is present. And the grandeur of tradition is to be able to provide that. As far as Islam is concerned, even the field of philosophy and science, which in certainly in England we do not associate with spirituality, I would say jokingly the main export of England in the mid-20th century onward is atheism. And all the atheists seem to be born in this island, I don't know why. Very few in France and Germany, they did it in the 19th century. Now at the turn of England. I don't have to name names, you know who I'm people I'm referring to. So one thing is philosophy and spirituality, what do they have to do with each other? In Islam, philosophy, especially as it grew after Farabi and Ibn Sina, every century became more and more immersed in Islamic spirituality. When we get to a person like Sohrabardi, the 12th century, the 6th Islamic century, this philosophy is really a spiritual philosophy. It exudes the remarkable metaphysical and spiritual insights throughout, even when dealing with the nature of substances, of matter, what we call matter, of forms in this world. And then when we get to Mulla Sadra and people like that, and Sabzawari later on in the 10th Islamic century or the 19th Western century with Sabzawari in the 13th Islamic century, you have a complete fusion of Islamic spirituality and philosophy. This is one of the greatest gifts that Islam can give to the world today. It is a world in which thinking and being are separated from each other. And if we talk about being in the existentialist sense, it's really an animal being. It's the ordinary consciousness of human beings a little bit over the level of their animality. That's why most of these existentialists are atheists. Jean-Paul Sartre, Simone de Beauvoir, you all know their names. But for us, philosophy was always combined, at least always in the last 700 years, with spirituality. And many of the Islamic philosophers are great saints. Imam Rizaq Qamshi, during the Qajar period, whom I consider the greatest philosopher of that period, along with Zanuzi's son, Ali Mudarris, these are two greatest philosophers of Persia in the 19th century. They're men of very great spiritual stature. And even science, we talk about mathematics, astronomy, physics that were transferred from the Islamic world to the West and made possible late medieval and Renaissance science, and against it the scientific revolution came, but it came against that heritage, was related in the Islamic world to a large extent to spirituality. As the Islamic science depicted a universe which was that depleted from spiritual substance. The spiritual presence was everywhere. And that's why as great a mathematician is considered to be one of the 10 greatest mathematicians of history, Nasiruddin Tusi, also writes Awsaf al-Ashraf, a beautiful little book on Islamic spirituality. The two were never separated. This again is a very important lesson for many of the young Muslims studying in England. Because as you know, Muslim parents, if the children do not study medicine or engineering, the mother faints in the kitchen and the father commits suicide. So all our young people are stuck studying these subjects. But these subjects were not always like this. They were always combined, even these subjects, with a spiritual presence. But Islamic spirituality manifests itself much more directly in other forms of creativity in Islamic civilization. Let me begin with Islamic art. Islamic art, of course, is one of the grand manifestations of Islamic civilization. And again, one of the greatest tragedies that has occurred in the Islamic world is the ugly cities in which we live, which compete with any city in the world in ugliness. And worse than that, some of the ugly mosques in which we worship, which are uglier than most factories in London from the Victorian period. I'm sorry I'm being so severe, but it's a very, very important point. The loss of the sense of beauty among many modern Muslims is as great a tragedy as not saying your prayers in the morning. I can say that because it gradually makes the divine unreal. God is beauty. Allah jameelun yuhibbu jamal. God is beauty and He loves beauty. Everywhere Islam went in the world, it created a beautiful civilization. From Indonesia to Morocco and everything in between. It was a hallmark of Islamic civilization. And what a catastrophe. What a catastrophe for us as a civilization that we produce so much ugliness. Indifference to beauty. We think it doesn't matter whether you pray on the asphalt or anywhere else. Of course, there's no other place in the mosque you can pray on the asphalt. God has allowed that. But to create places of beauty which reflect the divine presence was one of the great roles of Islam. As the great metaphysician Friedrich Schuon once said, religion is both truth and presence. Without presence, the truth becomes abstract. It becomes unreal. And without the truth, presence has no significance. Every religion must have both elements. And in classical Islamic civilization, Islamic art presented the presence of the divine, whereas metaphysics, the prayers, theology, all the other sciences represent the truth in its abstract or cerebral sense. You see this in the two great central sacred arts of Islam, in architecture and in calligraphy. Everywhere Islam went, from the earliest period, can you imagine, only 100 years after the rise of Islam, the Masjid al-Sakhra in Jerusalem was built. The Damghan Mosque was built. The Qarawiyyin was built shortly thereafter. The Qayrawan Mosque in Tunis. These are all mosques that go back to the first couple of centuries of Islam. Very rapidly, before everything else, before even producing books of fiqh, Islam created sacred architecture. Everybody must understand that. The books of fiqh came 100 years later. These are all among the greatest masterpieces of world art. Every single one of them. There are some also in Yemen. I haven't mentioned everyone. There are 7 or 8 mosques that belong to the first century of Islam. The most famous, of course, is the Dome of the Rock. You also see pictures of it, unfortunately, for Israeli tourism, but at least everybody sees the picture of one of the great artistic achievements of mankind. And that belongs to only 100 years after the rise of Islam. You consider that when Christianity came to Europe, the first important architectural work that is Christian is 400 years after the birth of Christ. It's San Maggiore Church in Rome, or one or two old churches. Very, very different. Islam very quickly developed a sacred architecture, which created sacred space that then gradually extended to the whole Islamic city. In the same way that in Islam, you can pray anywhere. Your home is a mosque. The floor of the mosque became the floor of all homes. And the ceiling of the mosque in those traditional cities where ceilings were connected together, you could walk over the whole city on roofs, became really the roof of your house. It was an extension of the sacred space of the mosque to the whole traditional Islamic city. And this monstrosity that we built today in the name of cities is really an affront to the whole message of Islam in a certain sense. Nobody thinks about it in these terms, but at least somebody should talk about it. Maybe somebody would listen here and there. I'm very, very pleased since I've been for 50 years talking about this, the number of wonderful architects now in the Islamic world. many of them my own students, who are trying to do this as much as possible. But it's not possible everywhere. I know that there are economic conditions, technological conditions, all kinds of things into which I will not go. But it's important to understand why Islam emphasized so much the sacred quality of architecture. Because that's where the word of God reverberated. The space of the mosque is for us what the icon is for Christians. That is the face of the word of God. Since we do not have figurative art in Islam for very profound reasons in which I will not go, the spiritual space, which was based on emptiness, was the great achievement of Islamic art in presenting Islamic spirituality. You cannot go into one of the great mosques without feeling the divine presence. That emptiness is emptiness vis-a-vis the world, but fullness vis-a-vis the spirit. The emptiness of the mosque is fullness in a sense. It's like la ilaha illallah. If you take the la ilaha to be fullness, then illallah is emptiness. But if you take Allah to be fullness, then la ilaha is emptiness. That's why you negate it. That's why you negate it with the la. And Islamic architecture is based on this principle. Complemented, of course, by Islamic calligraphy, which again is the depiction of the word of God, because all calligraphy in Islam begins with the Quran. The pre-Islamic Arabs, as you know, doodled along a few lines and here and there. They had no calligraphy as art. The art of calligraphy is considered traditionally to be invented by Sayyidina Ali, alayhi salam. The Kufic script is said to have been first used by him. He was a great calligrapher, unbelievable man. I mean, it could be a warrior, greatest saint, poet, writer of the most eloquent work in the Arabic language after the Quran, the natural balagha. At the same time, a calligrapher. I mean, it cannot be beyond our ken. How could God give so many gifts to one person? But that art, from the very beginning, was associated with the Quran. And all extension of that art into Islamic civilization came from the Quran. I remember when I was a child, I told this story once before in London 50 years ago, when I was first lecturing on Islamic calligraphy here. The city is, by the way, the city which produced the most beautiful work on Islamic calligraphy has been ever written in the English language, by the late Sheikh Abu Bakr Sarajuddin Martin Lings. God bless his soul, my very close friend. I don't come to England ever since he's died. I was so close to him. Something of England left for me when he left the world. His beautiful work on Islamic calligraphy explains this. I remember as a child, when we walked in the street, if a piece of newspaper had fallen in the street, pious people would fold it up, kiss it, and put it inside the hole in walls, which were kargela at that time, that is, they were made of mud, so that holes in them, because they thought it was from the Quran. Other might have been a completely profane story from Etalaat or somewhere like that, but in the minds of the people, a written word was God's word. And that was throughout like that Islamic civilization like that for centuries on end. And now, of course, we've trivialized writing, but nevertheless, the central role of calligraphy remains, and it's an art which connects the hand to the heart, to concentration of the mind. And it's also there for a spiritual discipline. People to draw one single sheen or scene like that is tremendous concentration, and you have to be able to pull from the right to the left, the forms back into your heart. A good calligrapher takes everything back into the heart center of his own being. And so calligraphy complemented architecture always as a great source of Islamic spirituality. And many Muslims feel that even today. Even in London, they try to have one good piece of calligraphy on their wall. It's something that exudes divine presence. Even if they're not Arabs, they don't understand the word of what's written, some verse of the Quran or some prayer. But the beauty of the form speaks very, very much to the Muslim heart and the Muslim eye. And one cannot underestimate that. Then there are all the other arts into which I will not go, such as the art of the dress. The traditional Muslim dress, both male and female, brought out the spirituality of the human stature, the human body. Whereas Western dress brings out the animality of the body. I'm sorry, I have to wear this kind of suit. I have no other choice. Otherwise, I wouldn't wear it for one day. But the beautiful traditional dresses, whether Arab, in Malay, doesn't make a difference, Indonesian, the different forms are bringing the spirituality of the body as God created it. God said, you created the best of stature, to bring that something of that stature. And there's a great deal of spirituality connected to that. And the loss of the traditional dress in the Islamic world was a very major catastrophe, almost as bad as the loss of the alphabet by the Turks, who changed the alphabet to Latin alphabet. It's almost as serious as that, a very, very important matter. And then all the so-called minor arts, which are not minor in the Islamic world, the division of major arts and minor arts is a Western concoction for Islamic art. In fact, these are very major arts. The arts at the National Art Gallery, you only see once a year. But the plate on which you eat, your wife puts the food right in front of you every day. That's the art that affects your soul. Not the painting of Rembrandt that you may see once a year. Yes, that's great art on its own. I'm not trying to denigrate it. But the art that surrounds human beings, Islam has spent all its spiritual, artistic effort to try to beautify the immediate surroundings of human life. Things which we consider to be minor arts, like, as a plate, a fork, a piece of cloth, wherever you sit, of course, the carpet, which was one of the greatest forms of Islamic art. And it came from Persia originally, but became a major Islamic art and came from the Islamic world both to China and to the West, almost at the same time in the 13th century, a little bit before that. In China, during the Mongol rule of China, when two cousins were ruling, one over China, one over the Islamic world, the first Muslim carpet we were sent to Beijing. And the first Chinese carpets were produced at that time, and then they spread and into the rest of China. Let me turn to another form of art, which for Muslims is very important still today, and which exudes Islamic spirituality, that's poetry and music. The Quran is not poetry. The word poet, said in the Surah Al-Shu'ara, the poets in the Quran, denigrates the poets. Because these were people who in pre-Islamic times would get paid to compose poetry. They're most like some modern scholars. You pay them to write anything. I'm sorry to say, I'm supposed to be a humble scholar myself. But who sold their pen, you know, they put it this way. And the Prophet was very much against this. And he was also accused of being a poet by his detractors, by the Quraysh, before they accepted Islam. And so I don't mean poetry in a negative sense, of course. In Persian, even today, when something is nonsense, we say shere, it's poetry. I mean, it doesn't make any sense, as in this pejorative sense. But in the positive sense, everywhere Islam went, it strengthened the art of poetry. And our poetry was so strongly molded in the pre-Islamic poetry, the Jahiliyyah poetry, that it took some time for Arab poetry to become Islamicized. The first poetry that became totally Islamicized was Persian. Because the Persian poetry began with Islam. And that's why Persian is so rich in Sufi poetry and mystical poetry. There's no Islamic language. That, I don't want to be too chauvinistic, I happen to be a Persian. But this is really the truth. It made poetry the main vehicle, actually, for Islamic spirituality over the centuries. And through it, all the languages of India, even Sanskrit, were influenced by it. But certainly the Islamic languages, Gujarati, even Malayalam in the south a little bit, Sindhi, Punjabi, later on Urdu. In all these languages, poetry plays a remarkably important role. Where is it in the world that even today, you can conclude a political debate in the parliament by just quoting a poem? Once you quote a good poem, you won the day. It still goes on in the Islamic world. And poetry is a very, very important art. And although we do have, of course, epic poems, we even have rajas, that is, poems of war and things like that, but most Islamic poetry, Persian and otherwise, except the Jahiliyyah poetry and what continued during the Umayyad period, including the poetry of Yazid, there is imbued with Islamic spirituality. The greatest Persian poets are the Sufi poets. Who has heard in this room of Qa'ani, or even Khagani, the great Khagani, but everybody has heard of Rumi and Hafiz. And these people transformed the life of Asia and the Ottoman world. It's amazing. Without Rumi, what would Ottoman civilization be? Without the Molavi order, where would it be? and what would be all of literature of the subcontinent of India, I mean, indirectly the Malay world, without someone like Hafez al-Sa'di. So poetry is a very, very important instrument or means of the conveying of Islamic spirituality, and it continues to this day to play a very important role. Even among the Arab nationalistic Palestinian poets, there are many who compose still Sufi poetry. In fact, in the Arab world, there's been a remarkable return to Ibn Arabi's poetry during the last 40, 50 years. Almost all the famous Arab poets of today are trying to go back to the Tarjuman al-Ashwaq and the Diwan of Ibn Arabi, and 20,000 verses of poetry in the Futuhat al-Makkiyah, which if they were to be pulled out, it would be a very large volume of poetry, several volumes as a matter of fact, and other great poets, Ibn al-Farid and others. As for music, many people think that Islam is against music. Of course, that's totally untrue. It depends what you mean by music. The recitation of the Quran is music, but it's not called music in Arabic. It's not called musiqa or ghana. But nevertheless, it's the highest form of music. It's just a recitation you heard today, you could take its notes down, you could write it down, you could write down the musical notes. But in addition to that, by banning lascivious music, or music that simply leads to passion, I mean external passion and passion for God, to sensual passion, Islam interiorized music. And what happened, especially through the Sufi orders, was a vast musical tradition was developed, in fact several, Arabic, Persian, Turkish later on, in the Indian, North Indian, Malay, Sundanese in Java, and so forth. These remarkable traditions of music, which all of which really in classical form derived from the spiritual presence of the Quran and of Islamic spirituality. I can hardly overemphasize this. It's amazing, so many Arabs and Persians living in London and New York, when they have a nostalgia for things Islamic, they put on some classical music of their own tradition. Even singers who tried to modernize Arabic music, the Abdul Wahhab, they couldn't do it. Out of the first few notes, they went back to classical Arabic music. And still you hear more Umm Kulthum today in Egypt than you hear any modern crooner. You do have the phenomenon now of these modern Muslim sort of crooners or pop singers and so forth that trying to imbue even this music with a certain amount of Islamic presence. But I'm talking about really serious music of the Islamic peoples. It's one of the greatest heritages of Islam spiritually, and it has a very special role to play in our day and age. We are living at a day when in Europe there's a tremendous wave of Islamophobia, the hatred against Islam, and in no country more than in France. But you go to the Fez Festival of Sacred Music, held in Fez every year in North Africa. Over half the population are French, who travel all the way from France to hear sacred music. I remember once Shahram Nazeri, the great Persian singer, the great classical Persian singer of Iran, who's a friend of mine, was giving a concert in Paris. And it was after the terrible earthquake of Bam, which killed over 10,000 people. And they're trying to collect money for to rebuild the town. And it was held in the municipality hall, which sat about several thousand people. And I went there. About 4/5 of the population were French men and women, who considered, most of them probably considered themselves to be atheists. You know, 40% of France considers itself to be atheists, another 20% agnostic or something like that. Altogether, about 60% of the people don't know whether they believe in God or don't believe in God at all. They're all listening to the poetry of Rumi and Hafez and going like this and in the seventh heaven. So sacred music of Islam has a very important role to play today as an ambassador of Islam to a world which has closed itself so much to everything else Islamic. And I think it's going to play an even greater role. We had a concert in Washington recently that was again show that the same kind of interest exists there. Now, having said all of this, I want to turn to how Islamic spirituality can cater to humanity's present needs. Of course, I'm not going to talk about social or economic needs and things like that. That's a story for another day, but even there it plays a role. But I'm going to talk mostly about human and spiritual needs. And I've chosen actually only four fields because it can play a role in so many different things. First of all, morality. There are a lot of people in the West who consider themselves to be moral but who are atheists. And they want to prove to God that they can be good without God. There's a dynamic within the human soul has fallen. To try to tell God, see, I can be good without you. And oftentimes they're more moral than the religious people for that reason, because they're trying to prove something. It's not that they're better people, but they're trying to prove something to themselves and to the people around them. But actually, morality cannot have a basis without spirituality. Morality without spirituality can become hypocrisy. And the hadith of the Prophet about that, and the Imams about that. Spirituality is the foundation of morality. The reason that our world is collapsing, where everybody talks about morality, is the loss of spirituality. It isn't that there were not wars before. There were wars before. It's not only Daesh that is beheading people in Syria. The British army beheaded thousands of people in India in the 19th century. People have forgotten that. Or the French army, even worse, in Algeria. The things that they did, nobody can match. They used to cut off the ears of people for just 2 francs. Any soldier brought out an ear of a Muslim would get 2 francs. Can you imagine that? It was the French were trying to carry out the La Mission Civilatrice, a civilizing mission in North Africa. But what we see before us today, even within the Islamic world, is a kind of pseudo-morality devoid of spirituality. And what we see in the world at large, when people talk about humanity and so forth, and there are wars all over the place, 1 million Iraqis get killed, and then Syria is torn apart, and Afghanistan, 600,000 people die, figures which are astronomical. And on both sides, the believers on both sides, both those who come to other countries to kill people, and those who make an excuse for them to come to those countries to kill people. Both of them are trying to talk about a kind of morality which is without spirituality. So morality without spirituality can be a very dangerous thing. It can become bigotry of the worst kind. Considering myself to be holier than thou and ordering people around, and if I have force, then to force them to do my will in the name of morality. This has not disappeared. It started when the missionaries who were doing it in 18th century India. It's still very, very much a part of our world. And the Islamic world is as much to blame as the Western world. You cannot just put the blame on one side. All of us are to blame for this. Then there is a very, very important issue, which is related to what I was doing in the Vatican last week, the relation between religions. We all know that we are in deep need of having good relations between religions. Almost all the issues that face one religion face other religions as well. From child pornography, to theft, to murder, everything, all the evil things that go on in society, different religions face it in different ways. And no religion has a monopoly on that. Unfortunately, we are sharing this. And it's most important for religions to be able to get together, even for expediency. But expediency is not enough. It's not enough to be polite towards other religions. One has to accept the Quranic message, وَلِكُلِّ أُمَّةً رَسُولٌ, that God has sent a messenger to every people, to have respect for other religions. Now, it's not easy to have respect for other religions, but religions have forms, and forms are very different in different religions. And if you only look at the form, there's nothing but opposition. I always say, give this example. A Christian, when he goes into a church, takes off his hat. A Muslim and a Jew, when they go to a synagogue and a mosque, put on the hat. And they're both doing the same thing. Both putting on your hat is a sign of humility, and taking your hat off is a sign of humility, in different ways. But since we're dealing in the world of relativity, the relative act seems to be opposite. But the inner intent is the same. It's time for us to be able to realize that we all belong to God, we come from Him, and we return to Him. When the Quran says, "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un," it doesn't mean only Muslims. all creatures, and the little mosquito also that bites you during the summer, comes from God and ultimately returns to God. All creation comes from God and returns to God. The Quran says this over and over again. You're always going back, every creation goes back to God. And so the whole field of the relation between religions is a field which cannot be really approached only diplomatically, but it has to be approached spiritually. I'm a veteran of this war of 50 years. I led the first Muslim delegation to the Vatican when I was a very young man. And it's been 50 years since I participated in the first Christian-Islamic dialogue, later on with Judaism. I've lectured in India to Hindus oftentimes. It's a very, very sad thing that because we play with the word spirituality, everything is going backwards. It was easier for a Muslim and a Christian to talk in London together 30 years ago than it is today. There's much less bigotry in Europe at that time against Islam than there is today. We've gone back to the Middle Ages, minus the spiritual element in the Middle Ages, which always held Islamic civilization in respect. St. Thomas Aquinas was trying to learn Arabic in order to be a good Christian theologian. You don't have Christian theologians trying to do that at Gregorian University right now. They try to learn Arabic in order to convert the Muslims, which is quite something else. So unfortunately, in this field, things are going backwards, but there's no possibility of hope for us in the future without paying attention to the spiritual dimension of religions. Religions can only meet at the center. They cannot meet at the circumference. God did not want to create one religion. He says so in Surah Al-Ma'idah. He wanted to create other religions. So as the Quran says, you could vibe with each other in goodness. And finally, we'll tell you who was right and who was wrong, who did well and who did not. So this is a field of very, very great importance, which I feel Islamic spirituality should address itself. I'm very happy to say that in this one field, at least, there have been a lot of efforts made in the last few decades in certain parts of the Islamic world, including Lebanon, in Iran, in Morocco, before the Coptic Islamic strife began in Egypt, then the situation deteriorated and almost all dialogue stopped. There's a tragic situation in Egypt, which still goes on. But there are many Islamic countries in Indonesia, which now has a very wonderful policy of amity between religions. 10% of Indonesia is Christian, or a few are so-called old religions of the islands, and 90%, 87%, 88% are Muslims. And there are very good policies being followed there for the last few years. And there are good signs here and there. There are also very bad signs, all the way from the Sudan to what happened in Iraq as a consequence of the invasion of Iraq. Christians had lived at peace with Muslims in Iraq for centuries. Not one Christian received a bloody nose during the whole 400-year Ottoman rule over Iraq. And the same with Syria. There's a story that perhaps not all of you know. In the 19th century, when Amir Abdul Qadir al-Jazairi was exiled, first to France, they were going to kill him, and the French officers protested because he was such a noble warrior, and so they exiled him to Syria. Once there was a riot between the Druze and the Muslims and the Christians, and a number of Christians were killed, and the others came and took refuge in Amir Abdul Qadir's house. So he gave them protection, gave the Christians protection. And later, the Ottoman Caliph sent Ibrahim Pasha, I think it was, his prime minister, to Syria, and they put on trial all the people who had killed a Christian. They were all hanged. They are all Muslims. All they were all hanged. And since then, you didn't have one bloody nose of a Christian until what you see today. The money paid from outside of Syria to destroy this wonderful country was a remarkable peace between the Druze and the Christians and the Muslims for a long, long time. So we live in very difficult times from this point of view, and I think it's incumbent on anyone who speaks about Islamic spirituality to speak globally. It's like speaking about the environment and only speaking about your city. And that's the next issue I want to turn to. There's no issue that is as crucial besides the religion itself and our soul and where it goes after death than the question of the environment. It's strange that people think this is some kind of banking policy. They have to debate 3 days at the G20 summit in order to decide whether to even include the environmental issues or not. And finally, Mr. Cameron, the very last day, says, yes, we're going to support the environmental fund. The environmental issue is actually a crucial matter of life and death. For those who do not believe in heaven and hell, that's why they're the people who most understand the environment and environmental crisis. Most people who are trying to defend the environment are agnostics. They're not people of religion. It took a long, long time for Christianity to even become aware of this. When I gave the Rockefeller Series lecture at the University of Chicago, which predicted the environmental crisis, the book Man and Nature, I received scathing comments against it from many bishops and churchmen of the Church of England, because I criticized post-medieval Christianity for being impervious to the importance of nature. Now, 50 years later, all Christian seminaries are trying to teach about the environment. And the Islamic world is even worse. Of all my books, I've written 50 books, and many in English, and some in Persian. My book, Man and Nature, was the very last book to be translated into Persian. And the environmental movement in the Islamic world is just getting off the ground now. Just getting off the ground, about 30 years late. They should have begun actually when this whole movement began. I used to give talk after talk in Iran, even on television. Nobody listened. And the other countries did even worse. At least Iran was the first country to have a national park system in the 1950s. We had the first national park system in Gorgan and one or two other places. In Egypt, in Syria, in Iraq, in North Africa, nothing. In Pakistan, how many talks I had given in Pakistan on this issue? Nobody was really interested, unfortunately, in these issues. But the environmental crisis is a major issue, and it's not a question of bad engineering. It's a question of spirituality. Unless we are able to see the spiritual quality of nature, all UN plans and national plans are nonsense. They're not going to get anywhere. We have to be able to understand that all creatures are God's creatures, that that tree has a right of its own. Al-huquq is not only our right to cut it when we want, do whatever we want to do with it. We have to keep the balance of nature. Yes, we feed upon nature, but we cannot transgress against nature. I've always said nature should be treated as one's wife and not as a mistress. She has her rights. She has her rights, and the rights have to be given to her. And these are all issues without Islamic spirituality will never get us anywhere. This is one among many. Now, let me conclude. My time is up according to the time that was given to me. I have 2-3 more minutes left. How do we gain access to Islamic spirituality? There are two ways. One is on a theoretical level. Many great works of Islamic spirituality, both Sufi and Shiite spirituality, have now been translated into English or French, and they're accessible, and many people make use of them. I know many Christians who have gone back to Christianity by reading Rumi or some other book of Sufism. I know tens of people. The second way, of course, is to try to participate in Islamic spirituality. And to do that, one has to be a Muslim. I'm totally against the pseudo-Sufism that's going on in Los Angeles and now here also in London and other places, which people get together and say a dhikr without even being a Muslim. That's like singing like Abdul Wahab, all right, fine. But that's not real dhikr. The condition of Islamic spirituality is to take the walnut as a whole, to have the crust as well as the interior, and to be able to benefit from the barakah Muhammadiyya, the Muhammadan barakah, without which one is not able to practice Islamic spirituality. One can talk about it, one cannot practice it. You need the succor of the Prophet ﷺ in order to take one single step on the spiritual path. And once we do that, we have to apply it. Where do we apply it? We first of all have to apply it to ourselves. The famous Chinese saying, the journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step, has many meanings, one of which is this. We cannot start any spiritual journey except with ourselves. We have to start with ourselves. Each person could be a lamp that at least illuminates its immediate environment. You cannot change the course of the Yangtze River in China, but you can change your immediate ambience. Not by talking, but by being. By being, that's what's most important. And that is not possible without access to tradition. Tradition, as we understand it, people like myself, with the late Dr. Lings and others, not tradition as simply custom, not the shop in Piccadilly Circus that says tradition and they sell old buttons from the British Army in India. I don't mean that. I mean tradition as a reality which descends from God, which is encapsulated and informed in various religions, and which alone gives access to the divine. You cannot invent your own religion. You cannot invent your own spirituality. Nothing that comes from God, that does not come from God, can lead to God. Only that which comes from Him can lead back to Him. Let me just conclude with a sad note, but not completely sad. Is anyone listening? That's the great question. Again, to quote Christ, many are called, but few are chosen. In our day and age, there are a lot of messages going around. The internet is full of all kinds of things. But the question is anyone listening really? And there are some people who are listening. I will conclude by this famous hadith, لا تخلو الأرض عن حجة الله. The earth shall never be empty of the proof of God, of Hujjatullah. This can be all the way from the 12th Imam to those people who bear actually the presence of God within themselves in this world. And let's hope and pray that in a humble lecture like this, at least some people will be awakened to the significance of the spiritual dimension of life, without which life is really not worth living. Thank you.